Now in verse 6, John begins talking about another John, John the Baptist. And again, we must remember that the Gospel of John was written anonymously. The author of the Gospel of John chose not to name himself. However, we know both through internal evidence and through external evidence of church history that John the Apostle is the likely author. We have that through church tradition, through church history. The early church fathers cited John as the author. And again, there's strong, credible reasons internally to believe that he is the author. But he chooses to just talk about one John. And again, this is further internal evidence that the author is John the Apostle. Otherwise, why would he remain unnamed in his own gospel? And why would he not refer to John the Baptist as John the Baptist, but simply John? It's because he's chosen to write anonymously. Now, he says that John came as a witness. This is another one of the themes of the Gospel of John, this theme of witness. And particularly in John chapter 5, we're going to see later that Jesus gets into these four witnesses that testify concerning who he is. In other words, Jesus doesn't require people to just take on blind faith without any supporting evidence that he is God. He points to confirming witnesses. And the first one that the Gospel of John mentions here is John the Baptist. So John the Baptist is a man sent from God. Again, another one of the themes of the Gospel of John, this theme of being sent. We're going to see this phrase, the one who is sent. Jesus uses this frequently in the Gospel of John, and it's a recurring theme, being sent from God. Jesus was sent into the world. Why? Because he sent as God's word to communicate to us the essence of salvation. Jesus is the message. He is the gospel. And his message is, believe in the Son of God. Through faith in Christ, we have eternal life. So John comes as a corroborating witness to bear witness of the light, Christ, that all through Christ might believe. Again, this theme of belief. He, John, was not that light. In other words, we do not say that Jesus is a light and John is another light and that Jesus is just one more, you know, light coming into the world. No, he is God. And so Scripture is very careful to distinguish between the person of John the Baptist, who everybody highly regarded as a prophet, and Jesus Christ, who is not only the prophet that Moses spoke about, the Messiah that all of Israel was anticipating, but none other than God himself in human form. Jesus is the light. John was not that light. John came as a witness to the light. That's why John, we see later in this chapter, he sees Jesus coming and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." It was revealed to John prophetically by the Spirit who Jesus is. And so he bears witness of the light. He was not that light, but was sent, again, this theme of being sent, to bear witness of that light. That, Jesus, verse 9, was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. Now this word true, again, this is another theme in the Gospel of John, truth. And the word truth actually could be better translated as real. In other words, authentic. Not something fake, not something just purporting to be something, but actual and real and truly the essence of what it represents itself to be. Jesus is the real light. He's real eternal life. That was the true light which gives light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. Now, I just see great irony here in this verse. Jesus was in the world that he himself made. Now, right away, we see through this statement that God is not some God, the God of deism. You know, deism teaches that some God created everything and removed himself. And so God is not an active participant in the world he created. But we see through Christianity that the God who created all there is actually, in the fullness of time, 2,000 years ago in space-time history, stepped into the very world he created, and he took on humanity. He became part of his own creation. That's a mystery, but let's face it. God being God, nothing is too difficult for him. He is sovereign, and in his sovereignty, he can choose to participate in the creation he makes. That's not too difficult for him. Nothing is too difficult for our God. So he steps into the world he made. He becomes part of the world he made, but the world couldn't even recognize him. And we see real irony here. Why is that? Well, let's think about how Jesus comes into the world. He doesn't come with his list of credentials, proving himself with all the things that you know, validate and substantiate his claim to divinity. Rather, he tests our hearts. He wants us to believe in him for the right reasons. And so the real test is, can you recognize God in human form the way that he comes into the world? In humility, in brokenness, not flashy, not going with the crowd that the world would love and esteem. Remember, the Bible says the things that are highly esteemed in the world are an abomination to God. And so we realize that Jesus doesn't come to try to win our vote. He doesn't come to try to impress us. He doesn't come and even beg us to believe in him. He comes, and in his coming, he tests our hearts to see what's in our hearts. We've got to remove all the things that would blind us from seeing Jesus for who he really is. John continues in verse 11 by saying, he came unto his own, but his own did not receive him. How tragic, again, the irony that Jesus Christ is Israel's Messiah. He came unto his own people. He came unto his own inheritance, but they did not receive him. And this should not have been. But we realize then that nothing is automatic. There has to be a preparation of our hearts so that we can receive God in human form rightly. We must prepare our hearts for an encounter with Jesus Christ. But he goes on in verse 12 and says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. This right is a legal word, the right to become children of God. It means that we have a legal right to become legal heirs of God through faith in Christ. That is something that God imputes to us when we believe in Jesus Christ. And of course, the new birth is part of this too, because through justification and through faith, a new nature is birthed in us and we become literally children of God by the Spirit. And so it's both. It's the right to become children of God. There's a becoming, and that is the new birth. The right is speaking of our legal status, and becoming is speaking of our spiritual birth. To those who believe in his name. Now, what does it mean to believe in someone's name? Is that just talking about nominal salvation? Is it talking about just praying a simple prayer and, you know, calling on the name of Jesus, going through the formalities? No, salvation is not a mannerism. And believing on his name, we have to understand what a name meant in the first century. That when we talk about the name, if someone came in the name of Caesar, it meant they came in the authority of Caesar. It meant that they, if for example, if they had Caesar's signet ring, then that ring represented that they had the same authority. Caesar had delegated his authority as Caesar to that representative. So to come in the name of another person means to come in their authority. So therefore, to believe in the name of Christ is to believe in the authority of Christ to save. And it means then that when we believe in his authority, we therefore submit to his authority. So therefore, we understand that faith in Christ is more than just nominal faith. It is a submission wholeheartedly of our lives to his authority. It's discipleship. And so we see that faith, real saving faith, means we believe, therefore we follow from the heart. We believe, therefore we submit our lives gladly to the authority of Christ. That's what it means to believe in his name. And then finally he says, who were born? And again, now we see again the new birth. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And so right away we see these two strong themes of justification by faith, righteousness that God imputes to us. We become legal heirs of Christ. We're legally adopted into God's family through faith in Christ. And we become children of God. We're born of God. And that is the new birth. And so this is a powerful doctrinal statement. John, at the very beginning of his gospel, is making this strong theological statement before we get into any of the story of Christ, the history of Christ, the deeds of Christ, these long dialogues between Christ and his adversaries, between Christ and different individuals. He's making this strong statement so that we know right up front who we're talking about. This is not Jesus, some good teacher, some human being who was maybe a little better than most. No, this is none other than God himself in human form. And so we need to understand that from the beginning. Understanding that from the very beginning helps us to understand everything else we're going to read through the whole gospel. And so he begins from this strong point of view. Jesus is God in human flesh.